Yeah.
So welcome to The Real Build. I'm your host, Bill Ryman, your broker builder. And today I have a special guest coming from Knoxville, Tennessee. Early in his career, he learned valuable skills hands-on in the construction field, such as framing, electrical, plumbing, and masonry work. He worked towards a degree in the education field at Middle Tennessee State University. While in school, he began his career as an inspector with Cluseau as an apprentice. In 2004, he came on staff as a full-time inspector. He has solidified himself as one of the most well-known and respected inspectors in his area. His young and energetic approach to his profession can be seen in every inspection he performs. In addition, his infectious personality makes the inspection process easy for every client. He's also a fellow Arte Syndicate member with me. Most importantly, he is a husband and a father of two boys. Dusty Jameson, welcome to The Real Build. Happy to have you on today. How you doing?
Good, sir. How are you doing?
Good, good, man. I'm excited to have you on. Like I was telling you, your first inspector I've had. We all know how important the inspection process is, whether you're in the construction industry or real estate industry. You are an important factor, especially to home buyers too. So yeah. I'm excited to get into that because a lot of people need to learn more on this topic because it is so important because it is one of the biggest purchases of their lives. Yep. And I bring that up constantly. So we're going to go into that big time today. So
Love it. Excited
to have you, man.
I'm excited. Thank you for asking.
Yeah, for sure. So I always like to get started with your background. So let's hear about who is Dusty Jameson.
I'll give you the short condensed version. So grew up in Knoxville area, kind of small town just outside of Knoxville. Pretty traditional upbringing into sports, football, basketball, had some siblings. We all, you know, did the normal things. Went through high school, got into college, went to Middle Tennessee State. Stayed somewhat attached to home. Middle Tennessee State's about 2 to 3 hours away from where I live. So basically during my time at Middle Tennessee State, I was still kind of attached. I was coming back during the weekend. So never really have moved out of the area. Traveled a lot of places, done a lot of things, but never really moved out. But basically in going to Middle Tennessee State, ended up taking on a job back here. So grew up here, born and raised, and here we are.
Nice, man. Yeah, I think I played a year of football at FIU. I think we were in the same conference too. So.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
So, Sunbelt. Yeah. That was it right there. So it's that's pretty cool. Small world. But let's dive a little bit deeper. I mean, obviously, born and raised in Tennessee. I mean, getting into the inspection world too. I mean, that is kind of a rare thing. And obviously, like in the intro, I talked about how you've done the construction stuff. So let's brush on that. Like, how did you learn, the trades and everything before you got into being an inspector?
So born in 1983. So if you do the math on it, 2004, I'm 21 years old. So it's not like I had any extended time to really get, like I said, I did some plumbing, did some framing, did some stuff like that. This wasn't long careers in those fields. Okay. So for me, it's more of, I grew up with a hammer in my hand. My dad had his hands on from, I'm talking young age, 7, 8 years old, doing different things. I remember, I think I was like 10, 12 years old, and we had to put shingles on a roof, and it was a relatively flat roof. And so we were just hands and knees all day long. My legs have never hurt so bad than they did the next day. But it was stuff like that. Growing up, we always had our hands on construction, doing different things. So in terms of having a background for it, I've always had my hands in the fields and the different things. I was going to school for something completely different. And in 2003, I graduated high school 2002. 2003, I had a friend of the family, and I started working for him when I was in middle school. He had a farm in our hometown, and he was so busy with work that he couldn't maintain that farm. They lived away from it. So I was his right-hand man on that farm. And again, it's middle school age, 12, 13 years old. I go down. My very first job was shoveling manure out of a cow stable or horse stable. But from there, it went, started going to building fences. And then he had a cabin that he built on that farm. So there I am helping build a cabin and kind of, again, hands-on. But in 2003, he had his inspection company, and I was in school, needed a summer job. And it was at that point, licensing, Tennessee did not require licensing for home inspectors. So when I came in from my first year of college, he said, hey, I just need some help, basic stuff. I need you to check plugs, carry my ladders, just do some basic things, help me get through the job a little faster because there's a lot going on. The real estate market in that time was booming. So I started doing that with him. That first summer, he offered a full-time job. He knew just through working with me for years, he knew I had a good work ethic. And so he said, you know what, I want to teach him this stuff and he can learn it. And he offered a full-time job. And at that time I said, no, I'm going to go ahead and finish up school. So I was going to school to be a school teacher. So that was the area out. My grand scheme was to be a school teacher. And I was wanting to get into coaching basketball and things like that. So, I went back for that fall, went through and over the weekends during that school year, I would come home and do home inspections. So nice. Saturday, Sunday, I was doing home inspections with him, helping him out. Did that for a full calendar school year, or a school year, not a calendar year. And then, of course, next summer picked up where I left off. And then at that time, he offered another full-time position again. So that's when I said yes. That was my, would have been going junior to senior year of college. So he offered again. I said, yeah, let's do it. And that's kind of when I started my full apprenticeship, kind of under his wing, learning the job. So that's how I got into it. So in terms of choosing over other industries or other careers, for me, it was school teacher, home inspector. And to be flat out honest, the pay was better here. That's all it boiled down to. And, you know, I can't say that I had everything together when I was young in terms of where I wanted to go with my life and, you know, kind of big picture.
We were all there, yeah.
It was small. Hey, I can make more money doing this than I can do this. It's where it kind of fell into my lap. So that's where it was. 2005 is when, or 2004 is when we really started getting into the apprenticeship. And here we are 16 years later.
Yeah, I love your story. I mean, that it reminds a lot of myself too. And I've repetitively said this in the past, like when I grew up, I always grew up working. I grew up with a hammer in my hand too. And, you know, I had a dad, same as you, that always made me work and always made me do things that probably that we shouldn't have been doing at a certain age. You know, I told a story about me, like you being on the roof pounding shingles, you know, you're probably younger and everything too. Well, my dad would make me do that stuff. But I have also told a story too, where I was younger, not really young, but you know, a teenager, and he was making me refinish his screen enclosure. Well, this thing was like 20 foot high. I'm up on a scaffolding, you know, and I'm sanding it and spray painting it for him. And it was just, he would find things to make me do and I'd learn, and he would just find things that he could make, you know, for me to make money. You want to make money, you got to work.
Right.
You know, that's the way I grew up. And with you and your background too, obviously being in the profession you are, that is huge, because there's not, I'm sure there are home inspectors that have a construction background, but not all of them. And that's,
yeah,
it's so important to have that background because you know the ins and outs. And I say that with real estate, with myself too, me being a broker and knowing the ins and outs of a home because I'm a builder too.
Right.
I can spot things that realtors aren't. Instead of saying how great the furniture is, I can say how, you know, the cabinets were built, how what's behind the walls, what kind of insulation there is, what the floor, you know, I can instantly say these things and you can do the same. Which is
Great. I think one of the kind of a light bulb moment was my first year back, actually when I finished high school before I went to college, that first summer I had to help my stepdad. He was a block and brick mason. And of course all summer, 3-4 months, I'm helping him out. I'm the mud man. I'm mixing the mortar and carrying buckets, carrying blocks and bricks. That's all I'm doing. I'm not laying anything. And I would, you know, get these guys set up and they would work on a wall, and I was just watching them trowel mud on a brick, and it was just so easy. There was no effort to putting all of this stuff in place, and they would fly down a wall. And I remember later on, 2-3 months into it, I remember picking up a block and thinking, well, they were taking a break. I'm like, I can do some of this stuff. And I pick up this block and I'm holding the trowel in my hand and I start to put it on and the mud's falling everywhere. That's when it finally dawned on me, not dawned on me, but it's the one that made it real. It's like, no, there's some skill to this. This stuff doesn't just magically happen. Like, there's some craft into all of this stuff. So it was interesting. That was kind of, I kind of woke up and like, man, there's some skill to this trade.
I mean, and that's the thing, and you learned it too, and I, like, I'm the same way growing up too. Like, I would try stuff, I'd be like, yeah, that kind of looks easy, let me put up some drywall myself. You do it and it doesn't look as great as those drywall guys, and then you teach yourself and you do it over, you know. And that's, I'm good with drywall now, you know. I can patch anything, I can do any, I can hang it, I can. So it's just, it's a great thing growing up and learning. And there's not a lot of people, unfortunately. I had a builder on my podcast recently, and we were talking about the younger generation getting into the trades and everything, and, you know, how lack thereof is there of, you know, kids wanting to swing a hammer. You know, they'd rather sit on an iPad or do something with technology. But we need people to continue to build houses, because, you know, we can't 3D print a full house. I mean, maybe they can, probably, but, you know, who knows by now. But where I'm at, you can't. So, you know, it's good. Going back on what I was talking about, though, you having that background and doing what you're doing too makes you the inspector who you are, and the top inspector who you are too, which I want to get into that too. So let's talk about, like, the inspection process a little bit, like, from start to finish. So, you know, that, so people know what to look for when hiring an inspector. Let's start.
Yeah. So most of my, I would say probably 90, 95% of my business all revolves around somebody's purchasing a home. They call an inspector. They've got a contract on it. They call an inspector to come in. So that's, with that premise, that's kind of where we're at. So on the front end, there's a lot of stuff that happens on the front end when we do scheduling and contracts and all that stuff. But one of the main things is we try to set up the process on the front end to tell the client, we're going to be there. Let's say an average house will take between 2 and 3 hours. We need that time. We need to be there by ourselves, going through that house, figuring things out. One of the things that constantly comes up, somebody will meet me on the front end of an inspection. They'll walk up to me and, you know, within 2 minutes, we haven't even been at the house, and they'll say, what's this over here? You know, at that point, I don't know. I haven't been over here. Not sure. But all of that to say, we try to set it up to where we're going to be there for 2 or 3 hours, meet us at the end. We're going to have a consultation time at the end. We're going to answer questions. We're going to go through everything with you at the end. Give us our time to do that. So with that, if that's the case, then basically during a home inspection, what I'm going to do as soon as I get there, I'm going to go into the house, turn everything up and on. I'm going to walk through the house, kind of get a feel. What I'm doing on the front end is I'm walking through and seeing where things are, getting lights turned on, I'm turning on exhaust fans, just kind of getting the house up and operational, turning on dishwashers, things like that. But I'm also looking on the front end, I'm looking for big ticket items, something that's maybe they didn't notice right off the bat. Mm-hmm. If there's something that's glaring, I may actually make a phone call on the front end and say, hey, I just went down into the basement. You may not have known this, but this whole sidewall is bowing and caving in. It's going to be an expensive repair. Did you know about that? Just to make sure. Every once in a while, somebody will say, no, I didn't know about that. We'll kind of walk through it and may actually cancel the inspection. They pay me a trip fee. That way they're not paying $400 or $500, whatever it may be. But in essence, once everything's up and going, I do my walkthrough. Then I just start from the outside, work my way from the outside in. I'm checking every system at the house. The goal is for that person who's buying that house to know everything that they need to know about it. Good, bad, and different. It's just a process. The main thing, I don't want that client calling me 2 months from when I do the inspection and say, why didn't you tell me about that? I would not have bought the house had I known XYZ. And as long as I do my part in documenting and presenting this inspection report to that client, then they're not going to make that phone call. They're going to have known about it. Mm-hmm. But check every system top to bottom. You know, we could get down into the nuts and bolts about technician type stuff, but you know, just in general, we're checking things out. We're making sure the house functions. We're not there to comment on cosmetics. The only time I'll comment on something that's cosmetic generally is if it's egregious. I may just say, hey, by the way, you know, this person may be out of state. Maybe they're not there. I may document a couple of things in the report and say, hey, your carpet's, you know, terrible shape. Just be prepared. You may have to replace the carpet. Again, just so they know about it. But usually cosmetic stuff, as long as it's not pertaining to the function of the house, or not a symptom of an issue, then I'm not going to touch on cosmetics. But basically electrical, plumbing, heating, cooling, structure, roof and attic, exterior conditions, interior conditions, appliances. Those are my systems that I look at. Are they performing how they're supposed to perform? If they are, then I check a box and say it's performing. If not, then I'm going to tell you what's going on with it. Our reports will probably have at least 100 photos with it. What I've learned over the years is that I could type out a long paragraph explaining this whole scenario, or I could type one sentence and put a photo with it, and that person understands that photo in one sentence better than they would understand a full paragraph of description. So we put a lot of photos in our report, and it's just a matter of translating the message of what's at the house to the client.
Yeah, basically a seller hates you, but then they love you when they turn into a buyer.
Oh yeah, oh yeah. that's a common thing. We do a lot of inspections for people who say, yeah, you inspected my house and you cost me a lot of money. That's why I'm calling you. So, you know, and.
But then they probably hire. But then, how thorough you are, though, that's the thing. When they go to buy a house, which they're probably gonna, who are they gonna hire? Are they gonna hire the guy that did a good job and picked out every single little thing that you can find that was wrong? Yeah, I mean, right. And being on the realtor's side of things too, you know, the major thing is, you know, I have to work to kind of calm my buyer down.
Yeah.
You know, and that's the realtors, because some realtors are horrible at that. They're horrible at, you know, they want to hit everything that the inspector has and say, fix it or my buyer's out here. You know, with me, I want to keep the deal alive. So I, a lot of the times I'll say, being a contract, I'll say, this isn't that big of a deal. You know, yeah. Like if a door doesn't shut all the way because the strike plate's not working, you know, I can fix that, you know, come on. You know, but there's the little things, but the major things, yes, we want to get those taken care of. They need to fix them and so on. Even, you know, so it's a realtor's job to help work hand in hand with you as well. You know,
exactly. And that's the key word is help. There's you know, a lot of times there may be friction between an inspector and realtors, just the general in general realtor. You know, the concept is the realtor wants to sell the house, they're getting commission for it, the inspector is there just to pick on everything, so mm-hmm. obviously two would butt heads. Their ideas don't line up. But the thing is, I have no reason to not want a house to sell. You know, yeah. And that's kind of the nuance of the job, is that realtors and home inspectors, it's not in a bad way, but we're working together to present this product. You know, my product is the inspection. And so I want a realtor and myself to work together. And like, yeah, you said, there are times where I have to calm people down. And the thing is, with a home inspection, if your home inspector says something and they are, you know, if they're just adamant that there's a major issue and they present this problem as something that's catastrophic, it's hard for you as an agent to overcome that. People put a lot of work, a lot of weight into what we say as an inspector. So the nuance to us doing a good job is to present it in a fashionable way, a very practical way. I usually like to tell people, you know, if there's an issue, I usually say, here's what you can do to fix it. Here's a couple of options. Here's kind of the worst case scenario, just so you know what it is, but probably we don't have to go to that worst case scenario. Probably a different repair will probably take care of. Mm-hmm. But I say that's the thing, is it's hard for you to overcome an inspector who paints a bad picture when something's really not that bad. It's a difficult process. So that's why we have to work together. You have to trust me as an agent. You have to trust me that I'm not going to blow something out of proportion if it doesn't need to be. Now, yeah. Obviously, if it's a problem, I need to say it, and I would.
Yeah.
But that's where the friction comes in, where you have to try to overcome something where somebody's telling, you're a builder. You know how to fix things. You, mm-hmm. you know, you've got a good understanding on it. One of the main problems that we've got is that if a home inspector doesn't have a really good knowledge base on how to fix things, or if they really don't understand the problem very well, then the default is to keep themselves from getting in trouble, which means defer to somebody else, tell somebody the worst case scenario, hey, you need to get a structural engineer because I can't make any diagnosis on that particular problem.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and all of a sudden a buyer's like, oh man, this sounds like it's big. Well, it's kind of because that inspector doesn't really know how to present that. He doesn't want to make that step and claim that to be not a big deal.
Mm-hmm.
Again, paint the true picture. Yeah. But if you have good experience base and you're able to make some determinations, be okay to step into that.
Yeah. Yeah. No, which is awesome what you said too. It's realtor. I mean, there's, like I said, it's the realtor needs to respect what you're doing, because if they're, whatever side they're on, you're working for the client no matter what. And, right. And the realtor should respect that client that's buying that house, you know, wants a thorough inspection so that there's no problems later, you know, because right. I've had inspect personally, you know, I've dealt with inspectors and they didn't do a good job, but I've dealt with other inspectors that did a real thorough, found everything, you know, possible mold behind a wall, stuff like that, that, you know, if it wasn't found, that could have been a huge problem. And who's that go back on? That goes back to you and it goes back to me as yep. a broker. Yep. So, you know, because they're going to point the finger at somebody and when they're coughing or whatever because of mold. So, you yep. know, it's something that's so important, and I preach on it, but it's also our job, like me as a broker too, to calm. And I could probably do it a lot better than some realtors because I've had to hold deals together, but me being on the contractors then and being able to calm them down and say, hey, it's not that bad, like, you know, or that's not a foundation crack, that's just a crack in the stucco, you know, stuff like that, to where they're just, well, what is the foundation? Is this thing going to go in the water, or what's going to, you know, no, you're right. on pilings, you're fine, you know? So it's just, it's a lot of talking, like, you know, and that's what you're good at too, obviously. And you showcase it in the report. Somebody wants to call you and ask questions, you know, you have the experience being in the construction field at one point too, to be able to tell them, you know, you might want to get this even more checked out. So,
yeah. So I had two scenarios today, and the afternoon inspection that I had, it was kind of unique in the sense that going through the inspection, and I did the same thing. I walked through the house trying to find anything major going on, really didn't see anything major, kind of knew my spots that I was going to be looking at. But what happened was I made my way through the inspection, and it was this accumulation of several different structural things that I finally, at one point I finally said, man, there's a lot of different structural things happening. None of these in and of themselves are really bad, but because I've got 7 or 8 different locations where I've got some settlement cracks, I've got a slab that's cracked, there's a bigger picture here, kind of put all of this stuff together. And it ended up, I knew this was a issue, but I kind of isolated it to be the primary issue, was the grading. This lot drained towards the house, and to fix this drainage issue, you're going to have to break up a driveway, a walkway. You've got to do a lot of major regrading. And so I told the buyer, I said, look, these cracks individually, this stuff that's happening structurally, it's not really that concerning. What concerns me is it's a symptom of a problem that we're not controlling water. And so if we control the water, then you can probably be okay with the cracks that are there. You may want to have a contractor here just to verify what I'm telling you. At the end of the day, I'm not taking on liability for that, but I think that you'll be okay structurally if you control the water. But if you don't control the water, these cracks that are in the slab, this wall that's bowed or that's cracked, this stuff isn't going to improve. You know, that's just something that I feel okay making that determination. And like you said, those cracks. So what I do is always say, I'll look at characteristics of cracks. We have expansive soils here. So mm-hmm. we're going to have really dry periods. And our soils will contract. Foundations will kind of adjust to that shrinkage in the soil. And then all of a sudden we get pounded with rain for 2 or 3 days or 2 or 3 weeks, and that soil expands. And then all of a sudden it's going to pop a mortar joint between some masonry blocks. As long as these cracks are not spread out really wide, as long as we're not shearing or offsetting, then you really don't worry too much about those cracks. Mm-hmm. So having a background now of, I've done well over 10,000 inspections. So having this database of 10,000 houses that I've looked at and able to go, okay, I know I've seen this before. I've seen this story many times. I'm comfortable stepping into this spot to make this determination.
Yeah, it's experience, hands down. I mean, you having all that experience and seeing the different things you have is awesome. I mean, you can't replace experience, yeah. And that's the thing. Yeah, and you being in the business as long as you have, it's obviously you've learned 10,000 inspections. I mean, you've seen it all, I'm sure.
Yeah.
You know, and later on, I want to get into some of the crazy stuff you've seen, or if you want to now too, that's fine.
No. Every time I think I've seen it all, I see something else where I'm
I take that back. It's the construction industry. Everything it changes every single day too.
You're always learning.
You're always learning. And if you're not learning, you're not going to be good at it. So
that's exactly right.
That's for sure. Let's talk about the different types of inspections you do. Cause obviously you're doing commercial, residential and ancillary, I think it was called too.
So basically, we've got our home inspection, and that's our bread and butter. That's where we're doing 95% of our business. We do jump over into some commercial stuff. I call it light commercial. In essence, if somebody's buying a commercial building, a lot of times it may be a house that's zoned for commercial, or it could be a full-fledged commercial structure. We're there telling them about the condition of its components. We're not getting into ADA compliance. We're not getting into sprinklers or elevator shafts or anything like that. We're there to tell them about the basic stuff that you would see in a home inspection just on a commercial building. So I'm going to look at the roofing materials. I'm still going to look at the electrical. There are times where the electrical in commercial, especially, you may jump into a whole different ball game with electrical systems. I may actually just hire that out. I'll have an electrician come over with me and, hey, you take care of the electrical stuff. But the commercial thing is really just telling the client, hey, it's going to be a glorified home inspection. I'm telling you about the components that are here, what condition they're in, how you use this structure. I'm not adjusting to that. I'm telling you what kind of condition we're in right now. The ancillary services. So those are the two structures that we're going to inspect, is commercial building, residential. The inspection process is just the visual aspect of all of its components. We step into kind of other things that we do. We were talking earlier, I do stucco inspection. Stucco is an invasive inspection. You have a lot of stucco there. Most of your stucco that you've got is probably on block. Is it on masonry?
Yeah, correct.
We have synthetic stucco, and then we have traditional hard coat stucco as well, but it's over top of wood frame. And so we have a lot of issues that come up because of the water intrusion that happens. It gets to the wood frame substrate and starts to deteriorate that. So a stucco inspection is basically going to I stick probes in through the stucco at different spots, areas that I'm concerned about. I check moisture content and substrate condition below the surface. So it's an invasive, more of an invasive inspection. I have to go back and seal up openings. I have to make sure everything on the wall cladding is sealed back up. So that's one of the ancillary services. We do radon testing as well. Mm-hmm. There's a bunch of different types of radon testing. We also do pest inspections mainly for residential transactions. We don't do anything. So most of our pest companies here are going to do the inspection, and then they also offer some sort of subscription type service where they come and do the treatment, or you get on with a subscription with them. We just do the inspection side. We're not doing anything in terms of repair or trying to upsell a different service. We are only there to tell you what's there now. We have no, that leaves us unbiased. But yeah, we do pest inspections as well. That's mostly with real estate transactions. We can do some well water testing. Those are kind of our key ancillary services that we do. Mainly, it's just a matter of when somebody's buying a house, if it has a well water system, they may want to get some of that testing. If they need a pest letter for their loan, we want to be able to offer that. Anything that somebody's going to need in terms of inspections, we want to be able to offer it to them. We actually subcontract. If somebody has a septic system, then we'll subcontract with a septic company to come out and do inspections on the septic tank. Also pools. Pools are pretty in-depth in terms of what can be there and the problems. We have done pool inspections before, but I've also seen pool companies that do inspections, and I know that the pool companies are going to do a better job. So I actually subcontract my pool inspections out with the pool company. So that if we don't do the service, we have a gateway to get to that service, and we'll provide that.
Okay. Yeah. And so you guys are full on doing, you're not even subbing out the pest control either. So you're handling all that in house and everything too, huh?
Yeah. Yeah. We, in essence, when I do a pest inspection, I kind of swing my hat around and I work for a separate company. Okay. Yeah, that company holds a charter, and then I have my certification with the state working under them. So it's all happening under my home inspection business, but technically at that point I'm a different employee, but providing. So if you're getting like a FHA or a VA loan, then you need that termite letter. It's a state certified termite letter. So if you need that, then we could provide that through that third party, so to speak.
Gotcha. And as far as, you know, your radon testing too, yeah. Like, are you, let's go into radon a little bit, because it's that test that everybody asks you about, and they say, do I really need it? Let's put it that way. So is it something that you think is worth it? Why would somebody go and get a radon test? Let's go into that a little bit, because I've gotten that on past properties too.
Yeah. So I think the easiest way to do it is to, on the front end, break it into two sections. Do you think radon's a problem? That's a different conversation. when you get into the science, into the potential health ramifications, and is radon more harmful than other things that we're putting into houses, that's a whole different conversation. I've got some opinions on it. But to be honest with you, there's so much information out there, and it gets so deep and technical that I can't answer it really fully knowing the answers to it. So let's separate that. Let's just say we are concerned with radon. We're following the Surgeon General's warning that it's the second leading cause of lung cancer. That's all the truth. That's where we're going now. At that point, then I would actually get into talking about testing, what devices are being used. The main, the main point with radon testing to understand is the longer that we can test, the more accurate the results are going to be. Radon is going to fluctuate, and any test that you get that's proper is going to have a tracking device. It's going to be able to read what the radon levels were over the course of 48 hours. Mm-hmm. And we'll see the radon chart go up and down. Now, if it rains, if it pours during that test, you're going to see radon levels spike. Mm-hmm. The science behind that is water's filling up the soil, gas is getting pushed out. Gas is getting pushed out of the ground, and then obviously that's going to come up into houses, and that's where radon levels can spike. So if it rains, we're going to bump radon levels up. Well, if we're testing during that period, obviously it's going to come back high. Maybe 98% of the year, it may actually be low. It's only this weather condition that caused that radon level to be high. So to kind of supersede everything is duration. Duration is the most important thing. The EPA has deemed that 2 days is adequate for a real estate transaction. So if that being said, if somebody wants to test for 2 days, we'll take your money. We'll put our monitor there and we'll test for 2 days. Now I'm going to pull this over here. This radon detector, this is just something, it's $100 on, or $150, you can get it on Amazon, wherever. AirThings is the manufacturer of this radon monitor. So it's got a one-day average and then a long-term average, I think, which is, I can't remember what the long-term is, like 30 days or something like that. Anyways, it's got a couple of different ways that it's reading rate on. It sits beside my work desk, or sits on my work desk beside my computer. I always just glance over at it. I kind of know what my radon levels are. That device, if my son takes that device and he throws it outside, I get home, he sees me coming home, he runs out there, gets it, puts it back on the table, I'll never know the difference. That's why that device costs $100. It's just reading radon, or it's just reading the radon levels, but I can't track what's happening with that device.
Yeah.
The other devices that I use for real estate transaction in that 48-hour period, I can read the air temperature, the air pressure. I can tell if the box was moved. I can see the hourly readings over the course of the duration, or the duration of the test. And that's all about tracking. So the difference between devices has to do with tracking. I need to be able, as a radon inspector, I need to be able to track my device, track my equipment, and make sure that there's no evidence of tampering. There's still ways around it. Boxes can still be tampered with, but you reduce your risk of something happening if you can monitor what's going on with your device. Now, I've actually tested my $1,500 device right beside my $100 device, and they read exactly the same. So they're both really accurate. Any newer device that you get on the market is going to be accurate, but it's just a matter of tracking it. You got to be able to track it. So we go, let's say we're doing a real estate transaction. Somebody asks for a radon test. Let's say I'm doing the inspection on a Friday. Wednesday, a lot of times I'll set it prior to the inspection. I'll go Wednesday, set my device, let it start reading. When I get there Friday, I'll be able to download that that test and have our readings on site. That's a standard real estate transaction test. If it comes back high, then that means radon was high in those couple of days. Now, we have, when we 4.0 picocuries per liter, I'm getting kind of in the science of it. So picocuries per liter, it's a measurement of air or of radon in the air. So 4.0 is our number. We want everything to be below 4.0. Mm-hmm. So if something's 4.1, it's considered high. Mm-hmm. In all reality, is that drastically high? No. You go to the northern states, you're going to see astronomical numbers, 500, 600 picocuries per liter. So we're kind of splitting hairs over a 4 or a 5 reading here. But technically, since the EPA says 4.0 or higher is too high, that's where at that point you would say, well, the radon test is high. You need to get a system put in. Oh, and by the way, a system could cost about $1,500. So yeah, it's... Yeah. If this radon level just spiked over the course of 2 days, somebody's having to spend $1,500, whereas the levels may actually be lower. Oh, if we tested for, so long-term testing is 90 days or more. If we tested for 90 days, we'd probably see a level, if it was like 6 or 5, that would probably drop back down, more than likely. We'd probably see it drop back down to a lower range during a longer test. But because it's real estate transaction, then we depend on this 2-day test. Mm-hmm. Kind of a steep cliff, if you ask me. So I always give people full disclosure on those. If you know, if it's just over the limit, I'll tell them, hey, if you tested for a longer period, you may see it actually come back lower. But you know, if you're trying to use this for negotiation, you won't be able to negotiate much if you're doing a long test.
Yeah, I've had to deal with that too, where it was a little bit high, and then you kind of are like, is it really that bad? You know, it was a tiny bit high, and then the inspector obviously has to tell what you said. You have to go by the book. You have to say, you know, it's high. I mean, you can pay the $1,500 for the device to put in your AC or whatever it is, and these people elected not to do it. And this was in a condo too, which is surrounded by concrete, which I know can, they, according to the inspector, can increase the radon levels as well. So, yeah, you know, it's one of those things, like you just said, that it's, you know, tough. I get a lot of people that are like, should I get a radon test? And I'm like, it's your call, your inspection. So I can't, you know.
What I've noticed is it's more of a transactional thing that's coming up, as opposed, you know, a lot of people aren't worried about the health because they're kind of like me. They're like, maybe there's an issue, but if I go to sell this house, somebody else is going to do a radon test and I may have to put in a system, so we're going to go ahead and do it now. That's what I'm doing a lot of that.
Yeah, yeah. Well, let's talk about some other ones too. What about mold? What are you doing for the mold test? Is it something similar? Is it? Let's talk about that and what people look for on that.
Yeah. So I try to talk people out of doing lab testing for mold. We do it. It's something we charge for. That's one of our services we provide. If somebody, a lot of times people will ask if they'll call the schedule inspection and they may say, yeah, I want to do mold testing too. And so I'll say, wait a minute, let's back up a little bit. Do you have a specific concern? Is there something that your family specifically has going on that makes you allergic to some spore? What is there something happening that makes you need this mold test? Or are you just generally wanting somebody to look to see if there's a mold issue? Mold is a byproduct of moisture. If there is mold in the house, there is moisture somewhere. It could be a direct source of water, maybe a roof leak, or we have a lot of crawl spaces here. And if you go into any crawl space right now, you're going to see a lot of water dripping from the underside of the floor. We're in a hot, humid time, you know, July and August are our bad months. So in a crawl space where there's water dripping from the floor, that's moisture, and that's going to collect on the framing, and that's going to cause mold to grow. I don't need to do a lab test to tell you that you have a mold problem. Mm-hmm. The mold problem is a byproduct of the moisture. Let's correct the moisture issue. We can come back and clean up the mold. That's not a big deal, but we got to correct the source of the moisture first. So it's something that every once in a while somebody will push on and say, yeah, I want to do the air sampling. I want to go ahead and do it. Hey, we'll do it. That's fine. But for the most part, I'm trying to say, let's just do a visual. When we go through to our home inspection, we're going to be looking for that source of moisture. We're going to be looking for mold. And if you say you want to do it then, let's do it then. But on the front end, let's don't pay that extra bit, because we can't control prices that the labs. I mean, obviously we can choose different labs, but they're all going to charge relatively the same ballpark. Mm-hmm. So when we perform the service, we can't just, you know, do it for cheap. It's an expensive process. So like our mold testing starts out at $350. Somebody's going to pay $350 right off the bat. It's like, you really don't need to do that.
And I agree with you. I mean, unless there's actually visual evidence, which I had a sale that I did where, you know, during the process too, I was with, we don't do remodels. So I got a guy that I always recommend, and he came in too. And we were both kind of looking around, and we start seeing water damage on the trim. Well, mm-hmm. You know, Hurricane Irma might, something happened in this building. I don't know if their sprinklers went off or something. It was a condo. And so we start looking around, we start seeing more and more water damage all throughout with the trim work and everything too. So that's when I recommended the mold test. You know, because that's where you find out, all right, is there mold on the drywall behind the walls? That's when you need something like that too. And obviously the inspector will recommend that as they're going through as well. Or if they don't, and I saw it, that's bad. It's, you know, I need a better inspector, but he did catch it too. So, I mean, that I see what you're saying on that, because it is an expense too. And there is people that have asked me on, even on newer stuff, should I get a mold test? And I'm like, it's a new house, but I can't tell you no. So, that's the thing.
Yeah. There are people who push it harder than I feel like it needs to be pushed. Mm-hmm. There are people who push it harder than I think it needs to be pushed. But for me, I actually go the opposite direction. And part of that, again, it falls back onto my experience. I can generally go into a house and kind of sense, well, again, it's all a byproduct of moisture. Where's the moisture coming from? It could be an AC problem. If the air conditioner doesn't run like it should, if it's oversized, for instance, if there's an air conditioner that's too big, it's not going to run frequent enough to pull the moisture out of the house. So mm-hmm. in that scenario, you would actually have, you could have mold that's on the surface because condensation's forming on the walls. Whereas if it's a crawl space issue where you've got humidity that's there, that's going to be condensation forming underneath. So there's so much that can be done on the visual side of it mm-hmm. that would negate the necessity for doing air sampling. Generally, air sampling, I could see it happening on a regular basis if somebody has an allergy. Is there something you're allergic to? You need to know if the spore is in the house. That makes sense.
Yeah.
Anything that, or if we've done stuff too for litigation. If there's been something with litigation and they needed an air sample, you know, we go in, perform the test protocol. And at that point they take it, but you know, outside of those two things, I think that the visual inspection is more important than the air sampling.
Yeah, no, I agree. I 100% agree. What about, let's go into, you guys have well water there. Obviously, we have sewer and city water where I'm at. And so it's different in different areas. But let's talk about well water or sewer too. How do you go about that?
So well water, basically, there's kind of two different tests that we do. One is the general test for coliforms and E. coli. These are bacteria that are in the water. If there is any trace of those in the water, then the homeowner needs to know about it because they need to get the system cleaned out. They don't want to drink that. That can make you sick. That's the basic test. FHA or VA requires the coliform and E. coli test, plus they require nitrates, nitrites, and lead. So it adds a few more layers. So if you're getting an FHA or VA loan and it has a well, you're required to have that test on file to satisfy the loan. The test is pretty easy. There's some technique to it. You know, we basically flush the system. Over the course of an inspection, I'll let water run and completely empty the tank. You know, there's usually a storage tank. So we're gonna dump everything out, clear the pipes. So we're actually pulling from the well. Mm-hmm. At that point, you pull the samples, take it to the lab, and let the lab figure out if there's any of those things in the water. It's okay. Basically pretty straightforward, but it's all about finding contaminants in the water. That's the goal for it.
Gotcha. And what about sewer testing? What do you do with that?
So I did one earlier this week, and the house was built 2013, I think it was. It's only a few years old. General rule of thumb, this is very rudimentary, but general rule of thumb, you should make it at least around 10 years before you have. So when you say sewer, are you talking septic?
Yeah, or general sewer, because it's all city sewer or whatever where I'm at. Some places were septic too, so it's kind of a mix.
Yeah, I've got a friend who's in. He actually was an inspector here, and he's down in Florida now. I can't remember what part he's in, but when he went down there, he started doing sewer inspection. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to delineate the difference. The septic would be septic tank in the ground. It's got a drainage field that's not connected to the city. That's a separate, we'll talk about that one separately. Sewer. So if you're doing a sewer, mainly what my friend Sean, what he's doing down there, and what you have in Florida, you've got a lot of slab houses. And mm-hmm. So you have waste pipes that are inside of the slab, yeah. They exit the house and they go and tie into the street. He does, because you're on slab, that's why he got into that there. Because to see those pipes, the only way that you can do it would be to stick a camera down and
scope it. Yeah.
Exactly, to scope it out. We have a lot of basements and crawl spaces, so we actually get our visual of the pipe underneath the house. So I don't do anything with cameras. That's the other thing that we sub out. Those cameras, to get one that you really would want, $5,000, $6,000. Yeah. And what I've noticed is the demand for sewer scopes is very low. I can't justify that money, so I'll just hire a plumber to come do it. But in essence, we don't do the sewer scoping. We hire a plumber to come out. A lot of times, if it's an older house, they may not be able to find a clean out, which means they have to get into pulling up a toilet. At that point, it goes over to the homeowner. I'm working for a client, but somebody else owns the house. That homeowner has to confirm that that plumber can pull the toilet. So there's a whole lot of logistics that has to go into it. But it's very rare that people ask for it. I've hired it and I've watched them do it and sending a camera down looking at it, but I personally don't do a lot of them because we don't have a high demand for it. So that what we do is just operate a lot of plumbing. We let tubs run for a long duration. If there's something major going on, it's either going to back up into the house.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say.
Exactly. There's going to be other signs. If something's happening, there's going to be signs. So we don't send a camera down, but we do things that would indicate if there's a bigger problem.
Yeah, and then that's when you hire to get the camera down there to see if the main drain is clogged somewhere, broken or something. Yeah, which makes a lot of sense. What about with, you know, because this is a big one where I'm at too, obviously being a more tropical environment. What about pest control? I mean, obviously where I'm at, you deal with palm rats, we deal with roaches, we deal with, you know, there's some places that have termites. So, I mean, it's Florida, it's tropical, and you're going to deal with stuff. So what do you, as far as pests, what are you looking at? What should people be looking for? And because yeah, that's a big one right there.
So the standards of practice for our state, which is what we have to go by at the bare minimum level, it actually does not include pests. It actually has a clause in there that says we're not there looking at pests. You need to hire somebody completely separate. Okay. So a lot of people are going to fall back on that and say, I'm not looking at anything. We have the right to do it. However, our company, there's things that the bare minimum standard, there's stuff that still, if you just went by the bare minimum, you're not protecting your clients, you're not providing a good service. So all of that to be said, we're not required to do anything. What we do, we went out and got our certifications, check for this stuff. And mainly we're looking for termites. Termites are really the big ones. We also have powder post beetles. Those are the two that we see the most of. We have subterranean termites. You have Formosan termites down there. So you have swarmers and you've got kind of a different. Yeah. We've got subterranean. So that's going to be the inspection in the crawl space or the basement. Those are the places that we're looking mostly for those subterranean termites. When they get into a structure, they build tunnels. And so you see tunnels coming up a wall. It's just a dirt tube. But if you see those dirt tubes that, you know, termites are active at that point, and you'd refer a pest company to come out and treat for that.
Okay. What about, I know my parents are in South Carolina. Carpenter bees, I think they deal with or something.
Yeah. Carpenter bees are a nuisance. We've got a lot of cabins and wood trim and exteriors and claddings. Mm-hmm. So carpenter bees are going for that. They're going to burrow into the wood. What happens is they burrow into the wood, and then woodpeckers come in and try to get in and find them. They'll actually lay some eggs in there. So they'll try to get in there and find them. So you'll end up with this long stretch of just damaged wood. That's because a woodpecker has been pecking on it, trying to get the bees. But we've got bees too. Treatment on those, there's really not much you can do other than just spray and try to fill the holes. They're a nuisance, but they don't cause the catastrophic damage like termites.
Termites
are, they're coming up, they're getting into the structure, whereas bees are generally on the cladding. And so it's more of a nuisance and an eyesore with bees versus termites. They're structure killers.
Gotcha. And kind of going into the next thing too. So let's say after the inspection's complete, you know, and what should, let's say, the home buyer pay most attention to after everything's done? What would you recommend on that?
So what we try to focus on, so when I was talking about the process of the inspection and when somebody comes at the end, kind of how we started out, we'll say, you know, we're going to tell you overall what each system, what kind of condition are we in? And this is going to be the overall feel for the whole system. We're not going to talk about all the little details that are going to be in the report because we would be there for 2, 3, 4 hours. But what we're going to do is we're going to hit the high points. And off of those high points, we kind of come out of that, I call it a consultation period. So we'll have a consultation period for 30 minutes to an hour. We'll come out of that consultation period, and there's going to be some kind of key takeaways. So for instance, that inspection I was talking about from this afternoon, when we left there, I said, you know, yes, you have some structural things going on, but these aren't really bad. Your key takeaway is all the things you need to do to address this water and what has to go into that. The other stuff, you could walk through the house and know that it needed to be renovated. You needed new floors. They were going to redo the kitchens and the bathrooms. I mean, you can kind of see that. Everybody knows that. I try to give the key features of that inspection so they leave that consultation period understanding what they're going to see in the report and what's important. Mm-hmm. As opposed to just opening up a report and trying to make those determinations themselves. That's where it helps you. The inspector is kind of saying, hey, focus on these things. These are your more important keys. Don't get overwhelmed by all the other stuff that's in the report. There's a lot of stuff that's in there. It's information that I have to tell you. These are the key things. The other thing is our software. Anything that's an issue with the house that we've got documented in the report, there are color codes, basically three colors, blue, orange, or red. And think of it like low, medium, and high in terms of concern. So if something's red, it's big. You really need to pay attention to that. Yeah. But it helps clients compartmentalize when they see a list of 20 items. If let's say 10 of them are blue, they can automatically in their head shift those 10 items. Now they're only dealing with 10 out of that list of 20. Now their brain is only kind of breaking these 10 things down as opposed to trying to break down 20 things. So the consultation period is really one of the key things. And then the way that we type the reports will help kind of seal the deal on what to pay attention to.
Yeah, and those reports are huge too. And the way you said you're doing it with the pictures and everything is big. And a lot of the inspectors I work with obviously take pictures so you can actually see what they're talking about. Because, I mean, it's hard to determine that. But I like the color coding thing too, because, I mean, if it is just a basic door not closing, interior door not closing versus a termite problem or a giant pipe that's leaking, you know, there's a red flag right there, which makes a lot of sense.
Yeah. So. And people seem to, so we switched over to this software, closing in on 3 years ago. And it's helped tremendously because it's like I said, that example of 20 items are wrong. Their brain automatically takes those 10 and pushes it off to the side because it actually, in the report, it's going to tell you, here's what these colors mean. And it kind of breaks down in a longer definition of it. But the blue items, it says maintenance or low level concern. It's stuff that their brain automatically shifts that out. And now they can kind of concentrate on these other smaller list items.
Yeah, which helps too, especially being in the real estate industry too. Because I mean, if like I said, like we talked about earlier, there are people that are going to nitpick every little thing. You know, if there's an outlet that's cracked, there, you know, an outlet cover that's cracked, they're going to want the cover replaced, and then they're going to want, you know, and I actually just sold my house, and I had an inspection, and the inspection was pretty thorough and so on. But I'm the type of person that's going to do those little things. I even patch holes in walls. I do, you know, you go above and beyond for people. Yeah. I'm big on you get what you get.
Right.
And so I was willing to do it, but there's other people that are like, are you kidding me? You know, so that's why I like what you're doing with the color coding, because it does take them away from those little things like, oh, you have a cracked outlet. You know, come on, you can go to Lowe's and get one of those for a dollar. So, you know,
it's frustrating that we're at a point where we have to make those comments. But again, over the years, over 10,000 inspections and having situations where people have called back and, you know, we're frustrated because this wasn't commented on or frustrated because this situation, there are times where we miss things. And if we miss things, we will take care of them. But, you know, it's frustrating. What I'm getting at is it's frustrating that we have to put a lot of that little nitpicky stuff in the report. But at the end of the day, I've got to be able to lay my head down and not worry about people calling me over, not telling them something. So this software actually gave me the chance to put it in there, but everybody else can understand that I'm not making that to be a cracked outlet cover is nowhere near the level of a pipe that's burst and leaking. Those are two things. And it helped a lot because, you know, when we had a software that didn't make that color code delineation, we're throwing all of this stuff in there and people are looking at us like, why are you seeing all of this stuff? You know, it's kind of like, you know, we're putting it on that same playing field where this is helping us not to do that. So it's helped so many different levels having a software that gives us that capability.
Yeah. Yeah. So, I mean, with the software, obviously that's helping too. So what about like, if they do have questions, how are you handling, you know, questions about certain things? Like, you know, what if they don't know what a lot of the stuff in the report means? Do they call? What happens when they call you? How do you handle questions, objections? How are you handling all these things, all the above?
Yeah, yeah. So questions about the report, generally the key points in the report are talked about during the consultation. But let's say that a client is not able to be at the inspection, couldn't really talk to them. We just emailed the report off to them. If they have questions, we tell in all of our documentation, call us. You know, we're able to talk with you through it. I've got good recall. People can call me. I'm driving down the road and they may ask me about an inspection 4 days ago. As soon as they say the house or some sort of feature, I remember everything about it. I can recall everything that's there. And the things that we find, yes, there's unique things that we find almost every day, but they're all still kind of the same thing over, you know, the course of the years. They all kind of falls into this one category of like, okay, there's an electrical problem, this needs to be done, or there's a plumbing problem, this needs to be done. So to be able to explain it over the phone without a report in front of me is pretty easy. Yeah, phone calls. I started doing Zoom meetings before this COVID stuff went on, and it was kind of a cool market feature that I had. Nobody else was doing Zoom here, and so, you know, I was kind of keying in on a little niche that I was able to sell. That, you know, realtors were using me because they knew I could do a Zoom meeting, and somebody may be buying from out of state, and they're able to talk with me face to face and see that I can screen share and do the report. COVID hit and everybody's doing it. But Zoom is another way. So yeah, if anybody has questions or anything like that, they either do a phone call, they do a Zoom, email, text. I mean, it's pretty much any avenue to get to me. Once you get to me, then I can answer questions pretty easily.
Yeah. And what about, so if you do see a major problem, obviously I'm sure you got contractor connections too, I'm sure, right? If
yep,
they did have a problem.
Yep. Yep. Well, kind of two things. So one would be every email that goes out, when we send out a report, it'll say, it's got a list. It says, if you need anybody, contractors, if you've got things that you're wanting done at the house, here's a list of people who we've vetted over the years. We know they do great work. So it'll give them a list of,
yeah, that's nice.
Yeah. So that goes out with every email. You know, if there are times where we have callbacks, and, you know, sometimes a callback, when I say a callback, means somebody calls and says, hey, I think you missed this. And so you have to handle those situations appropriately. We're not going to just brush it off. We're going to listen. We're going to hear what's going on. Usually I'll get somebody to email me, give me some documentation about what's happening. Then we go from there. And it's just a process. It's a process. We have a standard that we stick to. If we follow that standard and we follow that guideline, then we're going to protect our clients, and we're going to do everything that we do, everything that we need to do legally, we're fine. Mm-hmm. If somebody has a problem after the fact, if we followed our protocols, we've got documentation over that, we did everything that we needed to, I'm sorry you're having a problem, here's what we did to mitigate that risk, XYZ. And then on the opposite end of that, if they call back and they say, hey, something was missed here, and we go through and we're like, you know what? I think you're right. We'll fix it. I mean, yeah, we've done that. We've had one. We actually just worked through one about 2 or 3 weeks ago. An old water piping. It was cast iron piping. We told them this pipe was really old. We told them most of it was going to have to be replaced. However, there was one spot that had an active leak, and we didn't see it. And once we went back and looked at it, it was very evident. It had been leaking for a long time. It had actually damaged a duct that was right below it. It was clear. It was something we missed. So we hired a HVAC person to redo the duct work. We hired a plumber to fix that part of the cast iron. Client's happy, you know, just about owning up to it and doing our part.
Well, that's it. Yeah, right there. I love that. What you just said and what you guys did there too. Because we're a similar company. I mean, if you own up to your mistakes, people are going to respect you even more and refer you even more too. I had a similar situation. I've said this in the past too, with a plumbing issue. Wasn't the customer's fault. Our subcontractor didn't tie down. One of the studs, pipe was loose, vibration in the pipe, it was PEX pipe, went against a drywall screw, pipe burst. Whose fault is that? You know, and the customer told me, I do his home watch personally, and we took care of the whole thing. It should have never happened, and this was 5 years out of warranty too. So, you know, and it was something that should have never happened. It wasn't his fault. We took care of it. And that's what I respect about you and what you just said too, because you obviously run a similar company. Because there is a lot of companies out there, even inspectors, that would be like, oh yeah, well, that must not have been there. We wouldn't miss it. You know, too bad. So.
Yeah. And pretty much across the board, across the country, the contracts that inspectors use on the surface could really get them out of trouble. Mm-hmm. On the surface, sure, yeah. Got into the deep legal part of it. There are large lawsuits against home inspectors that are legit, and they cost inspectors thousands and tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of dollars. But on the surface, most inspectors are going to have a contract that says, if you have an issue, we are only accountable for what you pay for the inspection. So it doesn't matter if we missed $20,000 worth of issues. If you come back at me, I've got you signing a contract that says I'm only accountable for $500. Mm-hmm. That's on the surface. They've got that contract in place. Now, those contracts don't hold up. And if people want to sue, they can pursue and they can win. Yeah. But what I'm getting at is the conversation on the front end when somebody calls and having a problem. If you look at it and you can, for me, if we can look at it and we can legitimately see that we did something not to the best of our ability, it's not a question. You know, I don't care about what that contract says. I'm not fighting. There's no reason. You know, we've been around for a long time and we plan to be around for a long time. So to do that, we got to treat people right. That's all it's about.
Yeah. Yeah. That's with every company too. It should be with every company, but unfortunately it's right. not, but yeah. You know, one thing I want to talk, because it's so important too, like pricing. So what should people look for when hiring an inspector with like certain pricing? You know, obviously you guys are, I know how you operate. Not a lot of people know how you operate, but if they are hiring you, obviously you probably categorize what you're doing and price it out accordingly. Yep. You know, so what should they look for in that department? Why should they choose somebody like you with experience? You know, obviously your price may be a little bit high. I talk about this as personally as a builder, you know, right. Our quality, the way you got to pay for it. You know, we're not the most expensive. We're not the cheapest, but we do a good job. And that's thing. I'm sure you're the same way. So let's get into price.
You're going to... I think we can go a lot of different ways with that conversation, but to kind of keep it on track, you're going to find prices kind of all over the board. The general rule of thumb is that guys with less experience, guys who are just trying to break into the market, are going to generally be lower because they're needing to generate the business. They may be a great inspector. They may be a terrible inspector. Their value that they're selling you is price, because for some reason people depend mainly on price. Like, oh, well, I need a home inspection. They're all the same. This one costs $600. This one costs $300. That's a better value. You know, that's on the surface. That's what it looks like. There are some inspectors that are charging $350 that should be charging $600. There are some inspectors that are charging $600 that should be charging $350. You know, there's so much variation. It's on me as a business owner to sell my product to, like you said, you know, you build better quality. There are features that you put into your houses that are better. You can show this is a better product. Here is why this is a better product. It's the same for us. My responsibility as a business owner is to show the value that I bring and why the price is justified based on that value. So again, if I'm really trying to sell a job, you know, ultimately people are calling. One of the first things they say is, what's the cost? That's the first thing they say. And so if they're doing that, I will generally guide the conversation to, well, let's talk about what you want. What's your criteria for an inspector? What is, you know, experience level, years in the industry, certifications, knowledge base, I mean, all of that. Let's answer those questions, and then we circle back around the price. So,
don't you love that line, though? What's the cost?
It's so frustrating that the first question, I wish people would say, what's your experience? What's your years in the business?
I get it every day. What's your cost? Especially being in building, what's your cost or what's your price per square foot? And I go, well, what's your budget? Let's start there. Turn it around on them, because a lot of the time they're going to be like, well, you know, I have this budget and I can't touch it. You know, and I come back to them and I'm honest. I'm going to be like, listen, I'm honest. I'm going to be open and honest. I don't want to waste your time. Don't want to waste my time. Yep. I can't touch the house. I can't do it. You know, and then that kind of moves things on too, you know? So I'm sure it's the same with you.
Yeah. And there's the extra caveat too. If it's just me doing the inspections, if I have my company and I'm not worried about anybody that works with me, my price point's going to be higher. I I can't handle the volume of work, so I'm going to just jack my price higher, and I'm only going to go out to do higher price inspections. What we, and we did for a while, it was just two of us, but what we noticed, I noticed a couple of things. One, we were losing jobs over and over and over. We just couldn't get to them, and hand in hand with that was the market. I noticed it starting to change. When I first came on, we could book inspections 2 weeks out. We generally had about 2 weeks where we were booking things out. You know, somebody would sign a contract, we got 2 weeks to do an inspection. What I noticed was this shrink in the contingency period. Now it's at 10 days. Now it's at 7 days and 5 days. I mean, just this constant doing this. So for me, I made the decision. I said, you know, if I want to stay busy, I can either jack my price up, but what happens is if I can't get to the work and some other company is able to facilitate something quicker, I'm ultimately going to lose that customer in the long run. And when I say customer, sometimes it's a specific customer or sometimes it's a real estate agent. We get a lot of work from real estate agents. So I've got to accommodate to them. So playing the long game, I said, you know, we really got to get more people on staff. We've got to be able to get to things quicker. And ultimately, that's where we went to. So you've kind of got this balance of your price needs to still be on the higher end. That's what we're offering. We're offering a better inspection, but we also have to keep a certain volume going. So it kind of internally balances that price point. I'm still playing around, honestly, to be quite frank. I'm still playing around with a lot of different things with pricing. I've got one thing that's helped me is, you know, like I said, people call and they want a home inspection. And they think a home inspection is just this singular thing. There's no nuance to it. There's no difference between my inspection versus this other company. What I've tried to start doing is I sell packages. And so I've got basically three packages. I've got a premium, a standard, and then an economy. And I kind of break down the nuances of those and what's different about each level. And I can compare that to what this other company is doing. Mm-hmm. So if somebody says, well, this company is only going to charge me $375, you're quoting me $450. What's the difference? I'm going to go with them because they're offering the same inspection. Well, here's how these two things compare. And if you want us to match that, our economy level matches that price because that level of inspection is what they're doing. So it helps people kind of put that in their mind, like, oh, that makes sense. Well, I don't want that inspection. I want that standard inspection. Yeah. So I rate higher.
Yeah, no, I like that. That makes a lot of sense because you are right. I mean, when people think of an inspection, they're like, all right, I just need an inspection. Usually they go with who the realtor recommends. Yep. I don't know, just pick who that's what they tell the realtor. And then the realtor goes with who they're comfortable with or have a relationship with. But, you know, if somebody's coming off the street and really doesn't know what's required in an inspection, having that package bundle price too makes a lot of sense. So I like what you're doing there.
It's helped a lot. That one's helped a lot. And honestly, just routine practice, people calling and me scripting in my head and knowing kind of how to guide conversations, and you learn things. I mean, I'm one of those people who just, I get in and then kind of learn it. I do good with learning on the fly. And so having conversations over and over and over and over, you start to learn how to read people and understand what they're going for and kind of make it go a different direction if it needs to.
Yeah, no, I agree. What about some, you know, I like to talk about innovation too. Are you doing some new things? Obviously you're using some technology too for your inspections. So, you know, what are you doing to make it easier and better? What kind of innovation are you bringing to the inspection world?
The inspection community as a whole, it's pretty, there's a lot of conversation. I'm friends with one of my good friends. I talk to him every day. He's in Nova Scotia. He's a home inspector there. I talk with a guy from Atlanta area. Talk with him every day. He's an inspector there. I've got a friend that's over in Seattle. I talk with him every couple of days, two or three days. We have a lot of community online where everybody's going and posting different things. So there's a really open community. So in terms of innovation, everybody is kind of pushing different things and kind of stepping into different levels. I don't think I'm personally doing anything that's just groundbreaking, to be honest with you. There's nothing that I'm presenting that's this whole new thing and this is going to change everything forever. I'm just doing a lot of small things really well and increase just slowly adding layers. And over 16 years, I've been able to add a lot of different. So the package stuff, you know, doing that, that's just something that's kind of new. There's other companies that are doing it, but locally, I haven't heard of a lot of people doing it. When thermal imaging came out, you know, that was one thing that we jumped on board with and got into that. We weren't the first to do it, but now it's something that's part of our standard, our repertoire. The stucco inspections, I just got some certifications for that a few months ago. For years I've looked at stucco and I know the ins and outs, but in terms of doing the invasive testing on it, that's kind of opened up a different ballgame too. You know, like we had mentioned earlier, I got a job yesterday that was a good job, but I got it because I was on a website that promotes the certified inspectors for the area. And so I ended up getting a stucco inspection and that led over to a home inspection. And the more of these bigger jobs that I can do where it takes most of my day to do one job, well, the guys that are working with me can now do the other, you know, two or three inspections that need to go on in that same day. So we're not doing anything groundbreaking. We're kind of doing, we're following a lot of the trends in the industry, and we may do something a little bit newer that somebody else hasn't done locally, but they're going to catch, you know, they're going to do that soon after. It's interesting, honestly, to see how much people are trying to change and tweak the way that the process works. And I think there are some things that needs to be tweaked and needs to be changed, but there is, people need inspections. People need inspections for real estate transactions. You just don't, they need to know what's at the house. You can't really change that much. So do that really well and don't try to change with this whole new thing. Do that really well. That's kind of my idea.
No, I love what you said there too. I mean, you are right, because you are innovating, because each and every time you go out and do it, you're trying to figure out how to do it better, you know, and that's the thing. And the more you're trying to figure out how to get more detailed with it too. And that's innovation. That's how you're innovating too. So I love that answer too.
Yeah. Just layers. And sometimes, honestly, it's self-correcting. There's sometimes where you step into something, you think, oh, this is going to be good, and it doesn't work. And so it brings you back in. So it's part of
it. Yeah, exactly. This is one thing I wanted to ask you too, because I'm sure you've come across in 10,000 something inspections, you know, some crazy stuff. So, you know, what are some crazy issues or things you've seen in the past? You know, I'm sure there's a few of them that you've come across. Let's talk about them.
I've got two that are coming to mind. One was recent. One was several years back, probably 10 years ago. The one that was 10 years ago. So I go to an inspection. The client's not meeting me there till later. The homeowner's supposed to let me in. So I go up, and this house is overgrown. It's just a, I don't know, 2,000 square foot rancher style house, but just stuff growing everywhere. It's got a pool in the back. So I go up to the door and I knock on the door, and I hear it has to be 20 animals, just a ruckus going on inside. And I'm like, what is happening here? This lady opens the door, nice lady. And I look behind her, and there's dogs, there's cats. I can't remember what all there was. I think there was a ferret walking around. I mean, there was all animals behind her, but there were 15 or 20. And so I'm standing here talking to this lady like, okay, this is kind of weird. And when she opened the door, there was a weird smell coming out of the house. I mean, you could imagine how it smells. But we're standing there talking, and all of a sudden I hear like hoofs walking across the hardwood. And I'm like, what is that? I look over, there's a pig walking behind her. A little pig is walking back. So I ended up starting to do the inspection. And this house, she had a return air vent that was in the wall. She took the filter out, and she put a blanket in the bottom of that return vent. And that was a dog bed. That's where one of the dogs slept, was inside of this return. So we were circulating no air through this house. She wasn't using heating or cooling. I opened up one of the bedroom doors, and there's straw all over the whole room. That was the pig's room. That was actually, I go into the bathroom, and there's a hole beside the toilet, and we had a crawl space there. And this bathroom smelled terrible. Well, I look down in that hole, and I see that there's some sort of water under the house. So I already knew that was happening. So you can imagine the house, what it smelled like, all of that stuff going on. The pool at the back, the apron for the pool was draining towards the house. There was no drain, though, so it was just flowing against the back foundation wall. So I ended up opening the crawl space door. The toilet was completely disconnected, so it was dropping wastewater mixing with the drainage off of that pool. Yeah, so I didn't go into that crawl space because it was it actually had a it wasn't covering the whole ground. It was a trench. That's how long it had been doing it. It formed its own little valley out.
Wow.
The floor joints were deteriorated. I mean, that was, when people ask about the worst inspection I've ever had, that was bar none the worst one. I called the client on that one. I called him pretty quick. I said, hey man, this is bad. He ended up, he said, you know, we're getting it for a great price. We're going to gut it. I said, okay, cool. So we went ahead and did it. He met me at the end of it, and he pursued. I think he ended up buying it, and he redid a lot of it. But that was the worst one.
I had somebody actually, that's like deja vu, because I had somebody actually on my podcast, Tio Bogdan, and he's a home, he flips houses and so on, and he had a very similar story to that. So I wonder if it was him that bought it, but I don't know, because he's like, I walked in, there's animals all over this thing, and yeah, he was telling, because I asked him what was one of the worst flips that you ever bought, and it was very similar to what you dealt with there too. But maybe it was him, you know. I never know. Small world, yeah. Right? The other one,
that one was more just recent, and this one was more interesting, more from a technical aspect. So this was a 7,500 square foot house. It had a dock, boat dock. It was on the water. It had a pool. Just a big estate. It was hard coat stucco, which is 1 inch thick of stucco, metal lath, and then we have, of course, wood framed walls. And then it had a terracotta roof. So this was a really big project that I was doing. I actually hired a pool company to come check the pool. I hired a roofer to come check the terracotta. I didn't want to mess with that, so I just subbed those two things out. I had to do the home inspection and then the stucco. The home inspection, when I started going through this thing, an architect had it built, it was immaculate. It was in great shape. The home inspection for a 7,500 square foot house actually went really smooth. It was a short list, which is strange for that big of a house. Naturally, lists just get bigger as a house gets bigger, but this one actually was still pretty small, relatively. So my process was to do the home inspection, check everything out, and then after that was complete, I was going to jump over to do the stucco part of it. This was going to be a full day job, probably take me around 10 hours to do everything. So I finished the home inspection pretty quick, 3 to 4 hours, got through everything, finished it up, started on the stucco, and I almost made a phone call to this client and said, I almost called him because I looked at the stucco during the process of my home inspection, and it was installed really well. There were only a few minor things going on with kind of taken in how the house was built and how the stucco looked like it installed really well. I thought, you know, there's no reason that he needs to spend another $1,200 to do this invasive testing. This is probably going to be okay. Let's save him some money. Kind of last minute, I said, no, let's just be sure. He's a big investment for him. So, you know, yeah, I'm glad to do the work and let's go ahead and do it. So ended up getting into that stucco and I found quite a few problems. The walls with 1 inch concrete on the surface, they look great. As I would drill through and start checking the substrate, I was finding damage all over the place. I think I tested 40 different sites, and I think 16 or 18 of them had either high moisture content or just completely deteriorated substrate, which means there's a lot of water that's moved behind the stucco. Fast forward, this is what the interesting part of the story is. He paid me, and I'll just go ahead and fully disclose, he paid me, I think, around $2,500 to do all of this testing and inspection. He got a repair quote for the stucco repairs for $47,000. Add on top of that, a few other repairs that needed to be done with the roof that the roofer found. It was a total of $63,000 that this guy, the homeowner, agreed to pay for the repairs in escrow money. So this guy spent $2,500 with me and in turn saved $63,000 of repair work that needs to be done. So that was kind of a crowning moment for me. Sounds funny, but I mean, it was one of those things I'll always remember, that because it was it taught me a lot about the stucco. It doesn't matter how it looks on the surface. There's a lot that can go behind it. But the importance of an inspection and in a big purchase like that, like, gosh, I made a $2,500 investment. I just got back $6,000 in return off of that investment. So
yeah,
that will kind of always be on the back of my mind.
And I'm sure that guy's referring the heck out of you, too.
Yeah, He should be.
Yeah, yeah. If he's not, I'll he definitely
Google
should
review
be.
Or something.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. This has been great, and I'd also like to get into you, you know, personally. Like, one of the questions I've been asking everybody on the show too, it's a deeper question, but I love the answers. I've gotten different answers from everybody, and this question is more, what about you personally? I mean, you've built an amazing company and been a part of it, and you continue to grow each and every day. What lessons have you learned throughout your journey that we should all apply to our own business or lives that can help us grow? Deep question.
And I guess it's probably something I said earlier is don't really have the magic bullet. The grind, I hate that phrase, but it's the grind. It's the consistently chopping away, improving, whether it be business, life, relationships, somehow, some way, make small incremental steps to be better. That's everything I've done in life. It's always been about something small over and over and over and over. And you look back after 2 weeks, 2 months, 2 years, and you've completely changed who you are, what your business looks like, what your relationships look like. That's for me, that's where I've been most successful, is small incremental adjustments, changes, improvements. That's been it for me.
I love that. I love that, because I'm the same way, man. And that's what a lot of people don't understand. It takes the small steps over time to actually create change too, and a lot of people don't understand that, and I'm big on that too. So I love what you said there, because I can definitely connect with you on that too, as far as relationships, business. I mean, because you do see the change over time, but you got to be patient. That's a big key to it too, because not a lot of people are patient.
Yeah, and it's when we first started talking, and I said, you know, when I first got into it, not really knowing myself, not really knowing where I'm going, didn't really have a big outlook. I've been through things in life, and things have changed, and big events have happened and all that. But I don't know, I guess I learned the most about what I just said. It's very random, but I got into endurance running probably 2012, 2013. And it's crazy the things that I learned just from running and small steps, progression, starting with 1 mile and going to 50 miles, you know, making this progression, how much that translates to business. It's crazy. And again, translates to life, translates to relationships. But it's all about the small incremental steps, the small improvements. And then looking back in 2 years and going, oh man, I was there 2 years ago. Now I'm here. I love the correlation between endurance sports, running, things like that, things that I've been involved in, and business and life and stuff. So
yeah, I love that. Me too, man. There's nothing else like it, and good for you too, because you are making the right steps, and that's the thing. That's what you have to do, and then you should be grateful for where you've come too. You know, you look back a year, 2 years, and it's all about, obviously life's all about moving forward too, but you can look back at things with those small steps that you've made and see the changes you made and be grateful for it. So I'm 100% with you, 100% with you. One question I've been asking too, like, obviously I always ask about your past. Now let's hear about the future. So where will we see Dusty Jameson in the future? 5-10 years from now, what are your plans? Business-wise, life, where are you going to be?
Right? I've got a lot of plans now. Where I'll actually be, who knows? But no. I think my focus, I think I've got a long-term focus, and that's, like I said, growing a company, getting to a point where I'm not having to be in the field every hour of every day. My wife and I, we've made some sacrifices for our family. We've done some things over the last few years in terms of getting out of debt and what we're doing financially. And basically she gave me the green light to work my tail off for a bit. And in doing that, we've kind of stepped our life into a different area. But what's ended up happening is I've kind of carved out these work days that last 14, 16 hours a day on a regular occasion. And it's at the cost and at the expense of personal hobbies, things like that, family time, being a dad, being a husband. I think short-term goals over the next 1, 2, 3 years, I've got to get the company to a place where I kind of go into a different area of day in, day out, doing inspections 12 hours a day. I can't do that anymore. So I've got to kind of position the company to get away from that. And then I think long-term, I love inspections. Actually, I love doing them. There's a lot of people who don't want to be an inspector. They want to run a business, you know. I love inspections. So I still want to do part of that, but I want it to look different. I want to get to a point where the business is running itself and there's some residual, you know, coming off to me. And I've kind of formed that, and I can step out of that and step into what I am as a more specialized inspector, kind of doing some unique things, not just the grind of a home inspection. So mm-hmm. I think that's more of the long-term goal, but short-term, I've got to set up the business because right now it's me and then a lot of things that shoot off of me. I need to kind of pull myself back away from that.
Yeah. And I can respect that too. And obviously right now you're grinding out and, you know, like you said, you hate to use that word, but you are, and you're working 14, 16 hours a day, but you know, and I know you got two boys and everything too. And a way to look at it though, is you're working right now to better your family, to get to that level that you're going to be at, because I mean, I don't have kids yet. I kind of expect to do the same approach, you know, as I want to work. I mean, my dad did it with me. Like, you know, right. Was my dad there when it mattered? Yes. You know, yeah. He was always there for football games. He was always there for sporting events for us. That's what I remember, you know, as a little kid, him working all the time. Do I remember that? No, you know, but he was home at certain times. He'd probably pass out holding me, you know, cause he was so tired, but I don't remember those things. I remember the times that did matter as a kid right. too. So, and a lot of parents are like, oh, your dad's, you know, there's parents out there now that are like, your dad's never home, this and that, but kids don't think that way. Kids are looking at you because you are a hard worker. That's the way I looked at my dad. Now I want to be the same way. So,
right.
You know, right. You can never feel guilty for that too. So,
right. Right.
And obviously your wife understands. So she's probably the right one to be with yeah. too. So as long
she keeps me kind of reined in.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
We're probably similar in the fact that if you know, hey, a couple of days ago you had a phone call, I need to go work and do this. You know, I was right there saying, yep, go for it. You know, we rescheduled this podcast. So, but she kind of keeps it in perspective. There's some mm-hmm. times where I've got to rein it back, where I may be going full throttle. She's like, hey, a little bit of time here. Okay.
Which is a good thing too.
Yeah.
Which is definitely a good thing too. Yeah. Last question, Dusty, and this is what the show is all about. What exactly do people need to look for when hiring an inspector, and why should they go with Dusty Jameson as their inspector of choice?
Experience. It's all about experience. That's if anybody does the job for as long as I do, I'm not special or unique. I don't have some superhuman power that makes me smarter, better, or anything like that. If somebody does this job for this long and puts 100% effort into it, you're going to get good at it. So for me, if everybody's capable to do this job, the thing that I have the advantage on over most people, over a lot of people, especially in our area, most would be the experience. So if somebody's going to hire me, I'm going to give them my background. I've seen tens of 10,000 houses at least. That's just kind of a rough guesstimate. 16 years and doing a certain amount of inspections per year, I kind of got a good idea of what I've been in. So, you know, 10,000 houses I can pull from and get knowledge from, and, you know, doing this day in, day out for that long, that's what sets me apart. It's not that I'm, like I said, superhuman. I don't have any special powers or anything like that. It's experience. That's really what I offer.
Yeah, no, and that's huge in every business. I'm a big advocate on that too. So, I mean, this has been awesome. You know, I really do appreciate you coming on. It's a segment that I've been wanting to talk about because it is so important. It's such a crucial thing, even, you know, before buying a house and everything too. And and people need to understand it more and what goes into it. And I'm 100% positive we covered all that too. Last thing real quick, where can people find and connect with you?
All the social media, just search my name, Dusty Jameson. So Instagram, Facebook, you can search the company name. It all kind of ties back in with me as well. But Dusty Jameson, first and last name, Jameson like the whiskey. So
there you can makes it easy, right?
Right. Awesome.
Yeah, no, I really do appreciate having you on, man. This has been, this has been awesome too.
Yeah, likewise. I appreciate you asking.
Yeah, so I mean, guys, thank you as always for listening. Obviously, I don't ask for anything. I don't have any advertisements. Just give me 5 stars and comment in the comments. Please take 2 minutes to do it. I think I ask that every episode. You know, that's all I ask for. But thanks everybody for listening, and I will see you guys on the next episode.